Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome all the panelists for the session on NCDs, the impending wave. The moderator of the session is Dr. Anand Bang. He's a joint director at Search. Anand Bang is also a physician in public health from Johns Hopkins University. And Search is a non-profit organization working in the Gadchiroli district of Maharashtra. For the past 35 years, Search has been working on health service delivery, training, research and advocacy for influencing policy in the field of tribal health, mother and newborn and child health, chronic diseases and substance abuse. Dr. Bang is also associated with Tata Trust and he has been an advisor health for Chief Minister of Maharashtra. Welcome Dr. Bang, and I request Dr. Bang to introduce our three speakers for the session, Dr. Ravi Kannan, Dr. Prabhakaran, and Dr. Devdasan. Over to you, Dr. Bam.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Sudeshna, and welcome everyone. As we know, in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic, the healthcare system in India has been severely challenged. Large proportion of healthcare resources are dedicated to COVID management. And though we are sitting tight with the dread of the impending third wave, it is also imperative that we regain the focus on other essential healthcare services that had taken a major backseat. While COVID remains on our radar, falciparum malaria continues to infect tribal in Gadchiroli. Poisonous snakes continue to bite farmers during the ongoing kharif season. Neonates continue to get asphyxiated at home. And of course, the NCDs continue to affect Indian, urban, rural and tribal. In fact, Gadchiroli, where I am from, has stroke as the number one cause of adult death. Now, as we know, NCDs are chronic condition. WHO reports that in India in 2015, 5.8 million people die of NCD every year, and the number is only increasing. In fact, the title of this session can be debated as to whether it is an impending wave or a wave which is already drowning us. Additionally, we also know that people with pre-existing NCDs are more vulnerable to developing severe COVID. Considering the chronic nature of NCD, this can also have devastating economic impact on individuals and families, especially as we know that out-of-pocket expenditure is one of the most important causes of people being pushed below the poverty line. So NCD is a burden as a threat to progress of India towards sustainable development. Thus, it is imperative to focus on and fight against COVID, which is exactly what we propose to discuss through this session. We have three eminent experts. First, Dr. D. Prabhakaran, who is the Vice President for Research and Policy and Director of the Center for Control of Chronic Conditions at the Public Health Foundation of India. He's a cardiologist and epidemiologist by training. His extensive research focuses on epidemiology, biomarkers and role of nutrition in heart disease and diabetes in India as well as in the developing world. He is also the founding director of the Center for Excellence in Cardia Metabolic Risk Reduction in South Asia, one of the 11 centers worldwide supported under the Global Health Initiative of the National Institute of Health. Second, we have Dr. Ravi Kannan, who is an oncologist and director at the Kachar Cancer Hospital and Research Center at Silchar in Assam. He is a recipient of the prestigious Padma Shri Award for his outstanding service to society over the past two decades. He has transformed a small cancer center into a full-fledged hospital in Assam's Barak Valley, a remote area on the Indo-Bangladesh border in Assam. The institute aims to provide equitable and accessible healthcare to the people in the region, including accommodation, food, and livelihood to cancer patients. We also have Dr. N. Devdasan, the co-founder and ex-director of Institute of Public Health Bengaluru, where he continues to be adjunct faculty. He has worked with WHO Orissa and with the WHO country office in Delhi as the NPO in charge of communicable disease cluster, specializing in disease surveillance. Since 2015, his focus has been in the area of health financing, access to healthcare and health system management. A teacher by heart, he teaches health financing at the master's level. Let us begin the discussion with this. My first question is to Dr. Prabhakaran. Dr. Prabhakaran, we know that it is a myth that NCD only affects the wealthy. The rural and tribal population are equally affected. Now, considering the huge burden and the chronic nature of these diseases, how is our rural public healthcare system responding to the challenge of delivering care for NCD? Do you believe it is pertinent and possible that the community health worker should be engaged in NCD prevention, considering their remarkable contribution in RMNCHA as well as in NCD surveillance? And if so, how, if you can share with us?
Right. Thank you, Dr. Bang. I think this is a very pertinent question. Good morning or good afternoon to everyone on the platform. I just want to quote Charles Dickens, misquote him, to say that it is the best of times and the worst of times for NCDs. Why do I say that? Because worldwide, many countries have started witnessing a huge decline in cardiovascular diseases. Unfortunately, India is in the ascendancy. Just to give a perspective, in a 25-year period from 1990 to 2015, there was a 46% reduction in cardiovascular diseases and its risk factors in the United States. And in India, it almost doubled. So the leading cause of death in the 1990s was communicable diseases. And currently, NCDs, and particularly cardiovascular diseases, are the leading causes of death. The second problem is the response to that has been uneven in this country, but there has been tremendous progress in terms of response to cardiovascular disease and its risk factors across the country. Of course, there are variations. Many of the South Indian states, Maharashtra, Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh are doing very well, but many other states are still to gear up to the advancing epidemic, or I would even call it a pandemic, of cardiovascular diseases. Given that fact, there are two things which can make a big change in cardiovascular disease. The first is, of course, policy dimensions in terms of non-personal policy interventions for behavior change, particularly in terms of tobacco control, eating a healthy diet, and improving physical activity. We'll come to that later, because the question has been focused on health systems. What is the role of health systems in cardiovascular disease prevention and management? The WHO and the UN have two goals. This is something called the 25 into 25 goals. By the year 2025, we need to reduce the burden of NCDs by 25%. And again, the 30-30 goal, which is the SDG goal, to reduce the non-communicable diseases by 30%. And for that, I think the health system needs to be strengthened. And the primary care will be the focus of the health system, should take primacy in terms of the prevention of prevention and management of cardiovascular diseases. So clearly, the cardiovascular diseases have to take, the non-communicable disease management and prevention have to take a central role in the primary healthcare system. One of the myths about management of cardiovascular diseases is that it requires specialists. Only specialists can manage cardiovascular disease. That fact is not really true, because many of the risk factors, hypertension, diabetes, lipids, and several others, can be managed at the primary healthcare physician level. So here comes the question, what is the role of community health worker in this, or non-physician healthcare providers, because there can be a whole range of non-physician healthcare providers, which includes nurses, pharmacists, counselors, and community health workers, and what can be done through them. Currently, India doesn't allow prescription of medicines by non-physician healthcare providers, and therefore, the physician at the primary healthcare is central to the prescription, but a lot of other activities can be done by community health workers. In fact, empowering them with electronic decision support system or IT-based support system using the mHealth technologies can be a boost. And we have done several studies across the country in terms of looking at ways and means of using community health workers in terms of improving cardiovascular care. So what is the role for for the community health workers in cardiovascular care? So it encompasses a whole range. It's a spectrum, starting from health promotion, creating awareness, to cardiac rehabilitation for people who already have the disease. They can be trained and they can be provided with the electronic decision support system in terms of asking screening questions, in terms of providing health promotion messages to avoid smoking, how to avoid smoking, what are the avenues that are available in terms of avoiding tobacco use, what is a healthy diet, what is a healthy diet within your community, because each and every part of this country differs in terms of diet, what can be provided. So they can be trained on that and they can be supported by electronic decision support system. The third is what kind of physical activity advice that can be given. All of that can be provided. The second thing is they can schedule appointments to patients. They can, in fact, look at you can create a risk score for each of these patients for this electronic decision support systems, which can be printed out by the community health worker and given to the primary care physician who has a diagnosis, who has a background history, as well as they do have the advice in terms of what can be given to the patients. And in fact, when we spoke to patients, they're very happy because somebody is talking to them, somebody is taking care of them, somebody thinks about them, somebody calls them when they have to come for follow-up. Now, the next aspect, which is an advancement of this, is assisted telemedicine. A lot of people have been talking about telemedicine in the pandemic, but there are two problems, both from the doctor's end as well as from the patient's end. The doctors actually get frustrated because patients unnecessarily get into the telemedicine system. They don't get to the right specialists and they are unable to get all the details. Whereas on the other hand, people like me are kind of worried how do we get onto the telemedicine system? What are the things? There are some small things in the platform which people are not able to access, and therefore assisted telemedicine, where community health workers can be trained to in terms of accessing the telemedicine as well as providing them with point of care devices, electronic decision support system, handheld ECGs and so on and so forth, can actually gather a lot of information about the patient and that they can present to the doctor. So you can see there are multifactorial, multiple ways by which we can get community health workers to help assist in the care, cardiovascular care, particularly at the primary healthcare system. At the secondary and tertiary healthcare system, they can also provide assistance as physician assistants. And thirdly, some of the community activity can come from the traditional health systems. For example, yoga instructors can be used for cardiac rehabilitation, which we have demonstrated successfully after a heart attack to improve quality of life. I'll stop here. I've just touched the 30,000 feet level in terms of what community health workers can do. If Dr. Bang has some questions which are more granular, I'll be very happy to answer them. Thank you. Dr. Bang, you're muted.
That is fantastic, Dr. Babakaran. NCD must take central role. Primary care should be the focus. And it is a myth that only specialists can manage NCD, which is very liberating and empowering. And India must empower the frontline health workers using technology. My second question is to Dr. Kannan. Dr. Kannan, key message you have emphasized several times is that NCDs have shared etiology. So can you explain the implications of such shared etiology of various NCDs, including cancer? And in such case, how to develop and implement a concerted effort in dealing with these, especially considering the various cultural practices that may affect healthcare seeking and delivery across vast parts of India?
Thank you, firstly, for getting me to participate in this discussion. See, if you look at cancers, they are caused by tobacco in any form, arecanut, alcohol, poor dietary habits, lack of exercise, and in some infections that are not treated promptly. If you look at risk factors for a heart attack, tobacco, alcohol, diet, exercise. Look at risk factors for stroke, tobacco, alcohol, diet, exercise. We look at peripheral vascular. So the same set of etiological factors cause several non-communicable diseases. Also, if you look at individuals with cancer, you know, several of them would have had a stroke, would have had a heart attack, would have diabetes, would have had hypertension. And so, concurrent comorbidities are not at all uncommon. You know, some study I read, 1 in 4 Indians have multiple comorbidities. Mm-hmm. Now, so when we prevent cancer, see, cancer prevention is a big thing. All of us understand it is far better to prevent cancer than to treat them once they develop. So when we prevent cancer, we talk of lifestyle changes. Avoid tobacco, avoid arecanut, stop using alcohol, moderate diet, and a healthy exercise. And then when we prevent cancer, we are actually preventing cardiovascular diseases, we are preventing reducing the severity of diabetes, of hypertension, of COPD. And so what actually happens is when we go out to prevent cancer, we prevent a whole lot of NCDs. We're actually promoting health in the community. And cancer prevention, as you know, is economically a very lucrative business. You save money because you don't spend on alcohol and tobacco. You save money because you don't develop recurrent intercurrent illnesses. Cancer does not develop overnight. In between, there are a whole lot of other illnesses that happen. You don't need to go to the doctor and have investigations and treatment. And then your investment need for, you know, expensive cancer treatment is not inexpensive. Everything goes in crores. LINAC, CT machines, MR machines, nuclear medicine, everything is in crores. And so the investigation costs are also huge, not at all small amounts. And so you don't need to invest in all these infrastructure on that scale. And then most importantly, as a nation, we have fewer people falling ill, not only because of cancer, because of other NCDs as well. And so we lose less days of work. And so we expect the national produce to go up. And so all in all, it is a very good business strategy as a nation. Whether we are all geared up for it, whether we want it, that's a totally different question. See, we do several community programs, and we screen one entire health block in Kachar district. This basically, with the ICMR, this we are looking at cancer, early detection of cancer. And so we screened about 50,000 people, and we found about 200 people with cancers or pre-cancers. But we found 2,000 people with hypertension. See, what we did is we used the National Health Guidelines says that the ASHA, who is the community health worker, will mobilize the community to go to the sub-center and the PHC where an ANM will do the screening. The match doesn't favor that, you know. Each sub-center caters to a population of approximately 10,000 that has two ANM there. And then the ANM have hazard other jobs to do. They have to carry out maternal health, child health, immunity. So many things have to be done. Now, the ASHA are in the community. Each ASHA is responsible for a population of about 1,000. And out of that, screen eligible for cancer is about one third. There will be 350. So each ASHA has to screen just one person a day also. The whole community will be screened in 1 year. It doesn't take more than that. Whereas if we look at the math for ANM or in the PHC where a doctor has to screen, it will never happen in 5 years or 10 years. And so we tested a hypothesis about whether ASHA can be empowered to do cancer screening. There were a lot of objections, a lot of ethical issues raised. We had to answer four questions. Will the ASHA be willing to do this? Will the ASHA be trainable? Will they be competent enough to be trained to do this? Will the community accept the ASHA in this role? And most importantly, see, when healthy people are healthy, you know, and they work for daily wages, they can't be bothered to go to a clinic for screening and lose time and money. So we said we will do the screening in the homes of the population. The fourth question was, can screening be done at home? We trained the ASHA to use a tablet on which we had a predefined questionnaire, an app designed, you know, which asks about risk factors, about symptomatology. And we taught them to use a glucometer for a single CBG estimation. And we taught them to use a blood pressure machine, an electronic blood pressure machine. We taught them to examine the oral cavity, examine the breast, and inspect the cervix and take a smear. And then at the end of the project, we screened about 50,000 people. And the compliance was more than 90%. Whereas if you do an institution-based screening program, compliance will be far, far lower because people will not come. And then we found about 200 cancers or pre-cancers for all the effort and expenditure. But we found 2,000 people with hypertension, nearly 800 people with diabetes, and about 400 people who had both diabetes and hypertension. So the incidence of non-cancer NCDs is far, far, far more than the incidence of cancer, thankfully, you know. Now, so this, I think, is very important. We can empower our frontline health worker. And then they also go about imparting information. They had flip chart. They had videos on the tablet. They were very, our doubt was also whether they will be competent, they used technology, and they took to technology like fish to water, you know. And the few, Asha, who could not handle it, they had their nieces or daughters or daughters-in-law who did it for them. And so we were able to empower another generation also in technology. And so this is something that can be very effectively done. When patients come to the hospital, it makes sense to screen them for cancer. It makes even more sense to also screen them for other NCDs. And but then this has to become a policy. There is a policy change now. Now we have a registry for non-communicable diseases, and there is a policy for prevention of non-communicable diseases. But our data is not yet robust in this, you know. The cancer registries are mature. They've been around for a very long time. The registries for non-communicable diseases are just beginning to take off. But I think having a joint policy that takes care of cancer as well as other NCDs, and as Dr. Prabhakar mentioned, treatment of NCDs does not have to be diabetes and hypertension, does not have to go to a super specialist. Mm-hmm. We can use simple, non-expensive drugs. And, you know, many times, you know, we get dazzled by the array of expensive drugs that are available for hypertension, for dyslipidemia, for diabetes, you know, but there are cheaper, less expensive. The more expensive the drugs we prescribe, more likely are people to default when they have to purchase the drugs. Many times the drugs are not available in the government dispensaries, and when people have to purchase them out of pocket, they are expensive, they are likely to default. And once they default will become a habit. And so, that's all. Thank you.
No, I guess you made a great point. One, of course, you made a super strategy, business strategy for prevention. And again, I guess focusing on Asha is music to my ears also. I mostly feel that imagination of the medical and public health professional is really the only rate limiting factor as to what extent the Asha and the community health worker can be empowered. But you also made a great point regarding the healthcare cost, and it is exactly what I wish to ask Dr. Devadasan. Dr. Devadasan, we are aware that NCDs lead to significant healthcare costs, also limited ability to function optimally, endangering the financial security. In your vast experience and research, what are the challenges faced by NCD patients in accessing healthcare and sustaining treatment in India? And are we really prepared to provide affordable care to people with NCDs? You are on mute.
Thank you, Dr. Anand. First of all, let me express my thanks to Piramal Swasthya for inviting me for this discussion. Dr. Anand, before I answer your question, I would just like to put certain things in perspective. See, in most countries across the globe, healthcare expenses are met either by the government through taxes or by insurance companies through premiums. Rarely do people pay for their medical expenses at the point of care. Unfortunately, in India, this is the norm. This is mainly because in India, the government spends very little on healthcare. Just 27% of the total health expenditure was met by the government in 2018. Governments in 174 other countries spent more than India on healthcare. So that is, I think, our first starting point. Now to answer your question of what are the challenges faced by people suffering from NCDs in accessing healthcare. Naturally, with both central and state governments spending so little on healthcare services, most of our government facilities lack adequate human resources, medicines, diagnostics, and consumables. The patient then perforce has to go to seek care in the private sector, which means that she must pay for the treatment at the time of illness. This out-of-pocket expenses has various consequences. While it was okay for acute illnesses, you had a pneumonia or you had a diarrhea, very short term, you spent a few hundred or a couple of thousand rupees and it was over. But with NCD, that is not the case. This is a lifelong expenses. Month after month, you have to pay money for your medicines and your diagnostics, etc. So what happens is that now, if the illness is a sudden major event, like a stroke or an ischemic heart event, or even a road traffic accident, then what we have seen from our studies and other studies across the country, most families have to mortgage or sell their assets to pay their medical bills. This has intergenerational consequences. As the family is selling their future source of income, like land or a cow or gold, to meet this current medical emergency. Medical expenses are the third most common reason for indebtedness among Indians. Every year, about 10% of Indians are impoverished because of medical expenses, especially on NCDs, cancer being one of the highest reasons. So that is one aspect. But like I said earlier, on the other hand, if the illness is a chronic event, like for diabetes or hypertension or asthma, it means every month you require money for diagnostics and medicines. And like Dr. Ravi Kani said, today most of the practitioners prefer the latest generation of anti-diabetics and anti-hypertensives, which are very costly. And most people, especially among the middle income, lower middle income, and even middle income communities, families cannot afford it. So what happens? Either they do not seek care or seek partial care. So take the example of a diabetic patient. If they can't afford it, what does she do? She will stop taking medicines. And when she gets symptoms like giddiness or she feels tired, then she says, oh, my sugar must have increased. So she goes to the pharmacy and takes some, buys medicines for 1 week, takes it, her sugars come down, symptoms disappear, and then she stops the medicines. So this is what is happening today to most diabetics and hypertensives and your asthmatics, etc., because they can't afford to pay for the treatment. So it is not surprising why most of diabetics and hypertensives in India are dying at a young age prematurely, because people are not taking the appropriate treatment. Yeah, so I'll stop with this. And
I think you made a fantastic point that when it comes to out-of-pocket expenditure, India is actually an outlier globally. And I'm sure all of us believe that this definitely cannot be the vision for an Atmanirbhar Bharat, where every patient is asked to be Atmanirbhar for taking care of his expenses. And secondly, we will be completely losing our so-called demographic dividends if young Indians die of NCDs. But with this, let me come back to Dr. Prabhakaran. Dr. Prabhakaran, you briefly touched upon the various interventions which are needed in fighting this asymmetric battle with the NCDs, whether use of telemedicine or artificial intelligence, support system, newer as packaging of medicines, including polypill, role of traditional therapies such as yoga, but of course without any bleeding heart romanticism. Can you elaborate on these various various innovations, their role, and how to integrate those?
Sorry. Thank you, Dr. Bang. I think there are several innovations in terms of addressing the cardiovascular disease burden in the country, especially the premature mortality. So let me, because you just mentioned two, let me talk about only those two. The first one is polypill. Why do we need a polypill and what is a polypill? Post a heart attack or post stroke, within the first year, there is a very significant risk of having another heart attack or dying due to a heart attack or having a stroke. But the good news is it can be prevented by very simple drugs. There are four simple drugs that can prevent the recurrence, both in terms of heart attack or stroke. The simple drugs are aspirin, a simple statin, beta blocker for coronary artery disease, or an antihypertensive for a stroke, and a drug called ACE inhibitor. And all of this, when packaged together, can come within 2 to 3 rupees per day. So you might say it's very expensive for the poor, but still, that's the cheapest you can arrive at it, and the cost can even come down further. The big problem is, even if you give these drugs free to people, by the end of 1 year, 50% of the people drop out. They don't take the drugs. Second is the risk factor control in these patients, which is very important. And there is a physician inertia in terms of risk factor control. Like, for example, a patient comes, they measure the blood pressure to 140, like say 145 by 100 or so. Doctor will say, chalo, agli baar aajana dekh lete. Agli baar bhi, it will be 140 by 95 and nothing happens. Because we need to get the blood pressure at a good control below 140 by 90, preferably around 130 by 80 or so. So that kind of borderline inertia is there amongst physicians. What a polypill does is, we have shown this in trials. We did a trial called the Umpire trial around 8 years back, where we gave polypill to a group of people who had a heart attack and compared them against controls, where they got the usual care. So as compared to usual care, there was a 33% higher compliance amongst people who were given polypill. The polypill concept has caught on because secondary prevention, there's a clear role. Primary prevention, that is preventing the occurrence of heart disease amongst those who are normal, is much more difficult because people don't like to take drugs and people don't like to, even if they have high blood pressure or diabetes, as you're pointing out, they don't like to take these medicines. Even that there, also it has been shown that there is a 33-40% reduction in mortality amongst people who take polypill. The advantage is that the polypill has all the four drugs in a single capsule and it has to be taken once. There's no need for monitoring. Once we actually do the first run-in period and see whether they're tolerating their drugs, there's really no need for monitoring frequently. So that has been shown. And the only question now is, why is polypill not so popular despite all these evidences? Because many of the pharmaceutical companies don't like polypill because it is very, very cheap. It actually can impact profits for the newer drugs that come out of the market. And secondly, physicians are also uncomfortable because they feel that there is a loss of autonomy in terms of using a polypill so that they cannot give different combinations. But I think we can overcome that barriers because physicians can actually look at the art of medicine and look at new other problems which are there because these are common garden varieties of cardiovascular disease and stroke which require management. The second is yoga, you asked me. Yoga has a big role in two areas. One, to improve the lifestyle of people, to improve their diet. If you look at yoga, it has got eight aspects to the yoga, but I'm not going to get into all the eight aspects, but there are four important aspects. The first is called Yama, which is basically how we keep our environment. And we all know air pollution and climate change and environmental health are bad. The first aspect of yoga is to keep your environment clean. The second aspect is to keep yourself healthy, and that's where the various aspects of yoga come in, which is the right kind of diet, pranayama, which is the breathing exercises, meditation and mindfulness, which comes from various yogic practices like shavasana, etc. And the last one is the physical postures, various asanas. Of course, it requires guidance. We have to create a heart-friendly yoga, which we did. And we did a large trial of around 4,000 patients across the country in 24 centers where people were recruited after a heart attack and they were trained in yogic practices for 13 weeks and they were asked to practice this yoga. By the end of 3 years, 4 years, we completed the study and found that there was a mortality reduction, but that was not statistically significant. We are following these patients up because we did not have enough events. There was not enough power to detect that difference. Mm-hmm. But most importantly, people returned to pre-infarct activities. They returned back to their employment. They returned back to their work that we were doing much faster than in the usual care group. Depression was lower and they had a better quality of life. And therefore, clearly, yoga should be used for secondary prevention. We're also looking at the role of yoga in heart failure, which is a looming epidemic in this country. And there are various other things it can improve. It can improve the long-term control of blood pressure, improve compliance to drugs. So, as you rightly pointed out, without looking at it in a romantic way, but in a scientific way, I think there is a role for yoga. I'll stop here. I won't take more time on this.
No, this was great, Dr. Prabhakaran. I guess coming from you, what you also elaborated is that yoga is not just physical positioning, but it really involves the mind-body harmony and peace. And second, evidence generation is essential without making bombastic claims, and the outcome variables can vary, not necessarily mortality, but return to work and pre-infarct activity. This is fantastic. Dr. Kannan, then let me ask you your thoughts on one of the most important challenges in NCD management, which is the need for continuous monitoring and ensuring compliance, which is often lifelong. Now, understandably, it is difficult for only the formal healthcare providers to accomplish this. But what is your view on the health system's readiness to include the significant others or caregivers from the family as an integral part of this provision to NCD patients? And what are the various steps required for that?
So, as you said, you know, all NCDs require lifetime monitoring and follow-up. Now, our systems are not ready for that right now. It requires a lot more than, this cannot be done only by the doctor. It cannot be done only by the healthcare provider. See, for a hospital, you know, to deliver whatever be the goals of the hospital, they want to provide inclusive care, they want to provide equitable care, whatever, you know, this mission must percolate down from the director of the organization to the doorman of the organization. Everybody in the system must be clued to this philosophy. So in a healthcare delivery process where we have tertiary hospital, secondary hospital, primary hospital, PhD, doctors, nurses, ASHA, the whole lot of people engaged in healthcare must understand the importance of, you know, follow-up, of ensuring compliance, of going back and asking. And this requires concerted effort at educating the key players in the healthcare delivery system. And that requires formal training, that requires informal training, that requires use of technology, providing apps, providing tabs, many things can be done for that. The second thing that needs to be done is to educate the public, you know, the family members, the patients, and that patient and family education is a very big part, sometimes more time consuming than actual health delivery. It's easy for me to, you know, treat a breast cancer, do a mastectomy, give chemotherapy, give radiation, chalo job, that job. But then they have to take tamoxifen for 5 years or 10 years, and many of them will default. They will not know. They will not know tamoxifen has certain side effects, because of which they have to come back again and again. Same applies to diabetes or hypertension. They may develop retinopathy, they may develop. So this requires nephropathy, this requires constant follow-up. And this means that the family and the patient must be educated and re-educated every time they visit the hospital or they come in contact with a healthcare provider of any grade, be it a doctor or be it an ASHA worker, anybody must understand that every contact is an opportunity for educating and re-educating. Unless this happens, the third very important thing is mass media in the newspapers, in the government policies, and you know, we ran the population control program, Hamdo Hamare Do, you know, so significantly. So, because it became a mass campaign. And so, when we talk of NCDs, when we talk of health promotion, when we talk of wellness promotion, it has to get integrated into the national messaging system. Everywhere, somewhere, you know, even if it is 30 seconds, in a movie hall, in the public, in billboard. This has to be there. That, you know, this is a long-term process. There is no ease. It's only emphasizing, re-emphasizing, educating, re-educating as part of healthcare delivery that this will happen.
So doctor as the educator and doctor as the teacher, I guess that's an extremely important message for all of us, the professional, public health professional.
The word doctor means teacher.
Exactly. I was just going to say that it originated from that. I think essentially it is we all medical and public health professionals going back to our roots and need to open our hearts and minds to engage everyone in this battle. Dr. Devadasan, let me ask you the last question. We read of the labels of India as the diabetes capital of the world and the most depressed country. Now, what do you feel are the key steps required to making India healthy, happy, and in turn prosperous? And how can NCD prevention contribute towards this and India's economic development? You are mute, Dr. Devadasan.
Yeah, historically, India has been spending very little on healthcare. And I think some fault lies with us academicians and activists, etc., because we have been very passionate about putting health as a right and saying that the government should spend. See. But in the finance ministry, they don't see health as a productive entity in which they should invest. That is because they don't see the negative effect of ill health. So they are busy strengthening the manufacturing sector, the service sector, agricultural industry, but they forget that every year, 5% of our GDP we lose because of ill health, especially now with the NCDs. People lose, the young adults are losing productivity. There's, like I said, there's premature mortality. Caregivers are preoccupied with looking after the cancer patient or the stroke patient and cannot go for work, etc. So I think that is something that we should now change our tactic and address the economic perspective of health and saying that this is what we need to do to improve. I think that is the only message that our policymakers seem to understand. Mm-hmm. Then how do we, your question, how do we improve the economy, etc., by improving, preventing NCDs? I think Dr. Ravi Kannan mentioned it earlier, but I would reiterate that preventing NCDs is not easy, but there is a low-hanging, there are some low-hanging fruits, and one is tobacco. It is one of the main causes of cancer in our country, plus all the other diseases, COPD, CVD, etc. In 2011, the government received 17,000 crores as excise revenue from all forms of tobacco. In that same year, our society lost 104,000 crores because of tobacco-related ailments, nearly six times what the government earned. Now, these are the figures, the government's own report. It is not something from a research study or this thing. These are government's own report titled The Economic Burden of Tobacco-Related Diseases. And I think we should work on this to show that it is not worth the revenue that we are collecting and considering the loss that is. You see, some countries have already banned tobacco. For example, Bhutan is one of the few countries which has said no tobacco in the within the borders of Bhutan. Australia is moving towards that. So can we in India also move towards that? This thing to say that by 10 years, 15 years, we can ban tobacco. I think that would be a tremendous movement in terms of preventing primary NCDs. The other thing, yeah, I'll stop at this point, but I'll just want to, this thing is, the other, this thing is availability of medicines. We mm-hmm. did an action research in South Karnataka, and mm-hmm. we found that just by making sure that the primary health centers had the basic medicines for diabetes and hypertension, the mm-hmm. footfall of NCD patients increased by 50 times over 1 year period. So if the government can ensure that at least in the PHCs, they can, there are medicines, free medicines available for the patients, I think that would mm-hmm. be the first step in at least the secondary prevention of your strokes and your cardiac conditions and chronic renal failure, etc. I'll stop at this.
That is fantastic, Dr. Devadasan. We are taking a couple of questions which have been shared with me from the audience. Now, the first question actually pertains exactly to policy. Dr. Prabhakaran, let me ask you this loaded question based on your vast experience and PHFI, of course, that how do we engage legislators in policy making in NCD prevention, especially because the issue of tobacco also recently has come up? Or Dr. Paul, Vinod Paul, as he used to say, we medical healthcare professionals are too nice a people, difficult to really implement a policy change. Dr. Babakan, you're on mute.
Right. Sorry. I think there are multiple things in terms of communication to policymakers. Mm-hmm. The big problem for policymakers is there are multiple constituencies and they have to listen to everybody. And they are bombarded with information and many times contradictory information. So the things that are required is, first is, before we consider talking to policymakers, is to get a good surveillance system. I think that's one of the most important things that needs to be done, because you actually need to give real evidence to them. And we have to make the language simple and talk their language. For example, when we talk about what are the three things that can impact non-communicable diseases, we have to say there are Trimurtis. The three Trimurtis are physical activity, diet, and tobacco. Okay. And these three things, if you control, you can actually reduce 50% of the mortality anywhere in the world. Now, somebody might get up and argue, where is alcohol? You not put alcohol in this. So it's subsumed under diet. Now, you want to make it five things. You call it, it's equivalent to Panchabhuta or Panchaloka, whatever, five things. It include alcohol and add environment. So these are the five things that are required. The thing is, most of the policymakers have been fed this information that it is very, very important to create awareness, make people aware, things change. I think that point has been emphasized by Dr. Ravi Kannan. But I just want to add two additional elements to this. When we talk about behavior change communication, we need to do three things. We need to provide information to people so that they say, I know. The second thing is, we need to make them feel that they want, so that they say, I want. Third is that they should become advocates, so they demand for that change, and so that they say that I want. So I know I can and I want. And for all this, we need to create that enabling environment. So we need to provide simple messages in terms of policy. One of the things which has been successful so far has been tobacco control, like at least in the domain of smoking. Smoking has come down. It's not been there for the other things, so we need to work on that other area. In terms of diet, we just need to tell them that there are two simple things that need to be done: reduction of trans fats and reduction of salt. But salt is culturally rooted in our practices. We consume a lot of salt, so we require to change that in terms of providing the right kind. There are many methods. There's not much of time. I won't talk about that. But in terms of trans fats, for example, hydrogenated oils have high trans fats. So can we reduce it in a different way or form? That's one question. Like, for example, in Mauritius, when they stopped palm oil imports and used the locally available oils, the cholesterol level in the population came down. We need powerful information like that for people. Third is physical activity. And there are multiple domains in physical activity. It involves organized sector. It involves even, for example, let us say central government offices. How many central government offices people take a break after half an hour or 1 hour of work? They just need to stand for 2-3 minutes, walk around and come back and work. Either they are sitting or they are, you know, somewhere else. So we need to look at this regular physical activity. We need to provide an enabling environment in terms of the parks. There are a lot of parks in Delhi, but they're unused. They're used for criminal activities. So we need to create that awareness amongst that people in terms of community ownership of that parks, give it to people for walking. So it has to be a partnership between multiple stakeholders, including policymakers, the community, because they can change the policymakers. Of course, the physicians, academicians, and everybody.
That is fantastic. That is a great point, Dr. Babakaran. I guess the key thing is, of course, as you said, let the policymakers not be off the hook only by giving empty messages that this should happen in the community. Take example of Maharashtra. Get more than 10,000 crore of excise revenue through liquor selling and then give 50 crore for de-addiction. So it is not just band-aid when it comes to policy change or behavior change, but actual action. And second, as you rightly said, it is a long-term battle. Take time to really shift the goal over time. So deeply appreciate. Dr. Kannan, let me pass on to you a question from the audience. It is that it repeatedly comes that one side, we all believe that community health workers, ASHA, must be involved. But has it to be only ASHA, or do we require a new cadre of healthcare workers to be engaged for NCD control? What is your take on that? And what would be the support needed in such case?
Right. So when we started using ASHA, one of the criticisms that came was the ASHA is overloaded. They don't have time to do this. They have to do immunization. So we did a time motion study of the ASHA. And assuming they work for 26 days in a month, we found that their entire activity for maternal and child health comes to 12 days worth of time. And the rest of the time, they have available to get involved in other things. The problem is the ASHA are incentivized for every activity that you do. They are paid a retainership, though there is talk of changing this. But I think that is also a strength of the ASHA program. If we were to pay them a salary, and then, you know, nobody will be able to enforce anything. The advantage of having a group of community health workers like ASHA, who are incentivized on a task-by-task basis, they are accountable and delivery will happen. If the same thing were to be done through a cadre of paid NCD workers, you know, I think we will probably see a very different outcome, you know, and that may not be desirable. What we can do is, if required, I think for now to start with, we can work with the existing ASHA numbers. They have the time and they have the inclination and they are very well accepted in the community and most of them are trainable. We can, when we recruit ASHA, we can see they're supposed to be 8th class pass and we can change this a little bit, you know, ensure they have a little better education, 10th class or 12th class pass. If required, we can add to the number of the ASHA. But I think very firmly that is the way to go. It has the math, it has the process for remuneration built in, and we just have to provide the training. And this is not rocket science, you know, training ASHA to talk about prevention, to teach them to carry out simple screening procedures, to tell them to ensure compliance and make sure people take their drugs, go and periodically. They are from that community and they have only 1,000 people to take care of. And so that is probably the most effective way and quickly implementable way of doing it.
Dr. Kannan, this is fantastic. One of the Murphy's law is one accurate measurement is infinitely superior to 1,000 intelligent opinions. We Indians have national pastime of having opinions on everything generally wrong. Whereas your time motion study is a precise data on that. So I guess this is fantastic. And second, I again completely agree. ASHA is not the last appendix vestigial part of the public healthcare system. She is the first contact and representative of the community. So her voluntary status and performance-based remuneration is truly crucial. Dr. Devadasan, last question to you, then we can wrap up. How effective do you think is the PPP structure has been in prevention and control of NCDs?
See, what I will take this thing by saying that today our government system, we do not have enough human resources and we do not have enough material. And on the other hand, we have this entire private sector, which is also providing similar care, which unfortunately also we are not able to regulate. So personally, I feel if the government is more proactive in purchasing care from the private sector, saying these are the requirements. For example, you've got a general practitioner there, especially this will work very much in an urban area where there are a lot of doctors and these things. If you can say that, tell them that you look after this 1,000 hypertensive or diabetic patients and we will pay you so much, provided there is quality in terms of there's a control of their blood sugars and their blood, these things, etc. So this sort of purchasing of care, because there's no way that the government can recruit so many doctors and make sure that we cover all our 1.3 billion people. Let us use the existing resources and not think of them as private is equal to bad, etc., but work with them to strengthen our health system. I think that is what I would say.
That is fantastic. I guess this was a fascinating discussion. The key points that we have realized, NCDs are here, they are multifactorial, but we need not be paralyzed with the extent of solution required. We must attack the weakest link in the chain, as General Montgomery said. Healthcare for NCD must be decentralized and democratized, hence the role of ASHA. Prevention is the key. And as Einstein said, problems cannot be solved at the same level of consciousness at which they were created. Therefore, we need innovation. Thank you so much. I hope all of you enjoyed the session. I thank you all the panelists and especially you, the audience, for being part of this session. And now I hand over to Sudeshna.
Good afternoon. Thanks to all the speakers and the moderator. It's been a great session. We enjoyed, we could see a lot of questions coming in the session. And thanks patiently addressing all of those. With this, we end the session and we meet the audience again at 5:05 with the next session on Periods Don't Pause for a Pandemic. This is going to be an exciting session. We are looking forward to that. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.